also just like to note, if you do have a question that you didn't get an opportunity to ask, our panelists will be around afterwards prior to our Golf Ontario Award, so you'll have the opportunity to ask any questions you may still have. Continuing our panels, I'd like to welcome up Adam Helmer, Director of Golf Services at Golf Canada, who will give us an update on the strategic direction of membership models.
Good morning, everyone. Good to see a lot of familiar faces. Welcome to the member clubs, and thanks for coming on a Saturday, late February. The weather has been discussed, but it is a curse. We should just put that in the bulletin, the notice. Every annual meeting is cursed for us. Passion, a lot of words came up this morning. We had a provincial council meeting, which is made up of presidents and representatives from our provincial partners. And we were there at 7 this morning, and it was a good exercise. We kind of went through why we're all here and what golf means to us. So we could have gone on for days. We took almost an hour to go through it. So I think the level of commitment and energy from this group collectively, it's upon us to grow the game of golf in Canada. And so Golf Services, a newly coined term last year when we went through our strategic plan and the initiatives that we were looking at and grouping different areas, it really made sense for a lot of these areas of our business to come together and fit under the purview of Golf Services. So what we're talking about, membership, member services, amateur competitions has a direct link into here, handicap and course rating, as well as the rules of golf and rules of amateur status. So all these touch points in golf that impact the clubs, that impact our members, that impact our key stakeholders, and all of the associations. There's almost 100 associations in golf, as many of us know. So these are critical areas that, you know, we're looking at very closely, and it's a key part of our business, and we want to provide a more value to all of you, and we want to make your businesses better as we move forward. And you know, the research and the data that we're seeing is very optimistic in many ways. You know, from a membership standpoint and member services, we have all of our graphics and images that we look at, and we look at this picture. Many of us, some golfers aspire to be the next professional golfers. And some are just playing just for fun. It's a hobby. We have a great debate sometimes about, you know, sometimes we're the National Sport Federation. We call it a sport. When we're talking about rules or handicap, it's the game. To some, it's a hobby or just a pastime for some. So when we're thinking collectively of growing the game and membership specifically, people come in at different times. I think the former, for me, it was a game and then it was a sport. Now it's certainly a hobby with work and kids and family and everything else. I was down to 8 rounds last year, which was pretty much a career low. But looking at the images, hearing today that the plans for digital marketing and Vanessa and her team were really integrating membership with the commercial aspect, with the marketing aspect. We're bringing on experts in that field, and we're all facilitating it with the entire team, the membership team and Dave Stockton, and the entire team, and working with our provincial partners and our executive directors and our regional directors too, play a huge role in this whole piece. And even around the language, when we talk about membership, you know, I really like the word community. It came up a lot this morning in the provincial council meeting that a lot of us got into it because of family, community. You know, it's a positive thing that everyone wants to be a part of. So community, I really like that word when we're talking about the overall aspect and growing participation. You know, we all like the big number of 5.7 million people playing golf, but we're really looking, and we can drive them into the game and then move them into that avid category where we have 1.3 million playing 10 rounds or more. And then below that, we have a lot of people playing 5 rounds or more. So we have to be very specific and targeted how we're talking and how we're communicating and how we talk about the benefits of membership to these different groups. We know that we have 271,000 members. 90% of them track their handicap. That's a very key component and a key benefit for them. So I think as we go through this membership, I quickly want to look at this. The membership is a key driver in what we're doing and how Golf Canada and working with all of you is trying to drive golf. So the revenue that goes into it will go into golf services, so World Handicap System, rules, heritage. A lot of clubs probably call on Megan Gardner for pictures, for anniversaries, for information about your clubs themselves. So all that money is reinvested. The Grow the Game initiative, so Adam Hunter and his team looking at Grow the Game initiatives. High performance and trying to get the next generation of players. That's a very important pillar to us. Looking at the benefits, in terms of the club, I'm going to show you the member club benefits and then the member benefits. We've been working hard to get the value proposition up and add benefits as we go. The core benefits, I've talked about, you know, handicap and the score center. Even behind the scenes, trying to work with the score center to make it more robust, to get reporting, to get better detail on your consumers, because as a golf course, that your business relies on that too. Course rating, very important part of the handicap model. Course rating, we're investing in volunteers, we're investing in professionals to go out there to ensure that it's consistent, reliable in Canada, but around the world with the World Handicapping System. Hosting events, I think we've seen a change in mindset, the benefit of hosting events and, you know, doing your part for the game, but also showcasing your course. And it could be a huge driver when we go out to events. We'll talk on the events panel, but sometimes, depending on the event, it's a driver for your membership and bringing new people into your club, hosting events and the exposure, and working with our communication team to make sure that we are on social. We're giving you more benefits as of just giving up your golf course for the week or for the tournament. Spoke about junior programming, supporting our next generation. So these are kind of the core benefits that are there. And now we're trying to add on to this with the incident protection program. This one can't be understated. Since 2015, it has just escalated and gone up. People, we saw 150% increase last year. So with the incident protection program, with lost, stolen, or damaged clubs, broken windows, could be a car, could be the clubhouse window, depending how close it is to 18. And for carts too. So I think for the clubs and for the golfer, hopefully you're seeing the benefits in this incident protection program, where it kind of takes down that awkward conversation between the golf shop and the golfer that just rolled the cart. And we saw in 19 and 20 with the Rules Modernization Initiative and the World Handicap System. And in terms of the member benefits, so looking at the member, our core membership group, and then we've heard a lot about the public player and the public player acquisition that we're going after, that big number of avid golfers. You know, we want to get net new people into the community. We want new golfers in your area, and we want to drive them to your golf course. So we're working collectively to try and find these people and drive them to your golf course, because they're out there, they're playing golf, they want to get out and play more. So the core benefits, again, the handicap was a huge one for a lot of our members. The equipment ID labels is another one, too, that is really important, and I think has shown that people lose their stuff and people want to get it back. The discounts, the complexity of membership, I guess, with these groups and the discounts and everything else, we're trying to figure out a good balance collectively that helps the clubs, but also helps Golf Canada attract and achieve a bigger group to drive everything that we're doing in all areas across of our business. And then again, everything that the member club receives, most of it is passed on to the member. We heard yesterday in the kickoff, and the commercial team and John Sibley has been working. Any partner that comes in, membership is going to be a big focus of that conversation. How can we provide more value? And Avis and Hilton coming on last year will hopefully see more success moving forward, and we'll continue to add on and layer in these benefits to members. Our conversations around where we're going, it's not a straight direct line. We're not going at the bullseye. It's going to be a couple paths. We're going to have to try a couple things. We want to move fast in certain areas. We hear technology where we want to get into that and make sure that it's a benefit, and make sure that we're talking to all of our groups. It's really win-win if we're able to get them within our ecosystem and make sure that we can talk to them and engage them. So our entire member services team, again, our regional directors for across Canada, Most of you know Ryan Logan from Ontario, but he's going to be calling on you. Please call him. We want to know. That's what we're investing in, so that we could hear the conversations. What are the opportunities? What are the challenges? It's very dynamic, and it's changing quickly. The provincial associations, we've had a lot of great meetings. This meeting in general, it's a chance for all of us to come together, to realign, to look at our strategic plan, to make sure we're on the same page, to make sure we're doing the same thing, and make sure our priorities are set accordingly. The research, great intel and information, the industry forums. We had a couple industry forums last year, and the objective was to just start that dialogue again. We're going to do more with this. Were they perfect? Probably not. They were good to get out there, to listen, to hear those conversations. So we're going to kind of reanalyze what that is and how we approach that regionally and provincially across the country. I quickly talked on amateur competitions and events, but our events, this will be the first year we're not setting a new record. 2018 and 2019, we ran 31 and 32 competitions. We're at 29 competitions. So in the short time span, we're running qualifiers, our international partnership with the USGA, really a benefit to our players here in Canada, an opportunity for them. We've looked at our junior competitive structure. We've looked at, I've got a great tool and resource to show you for parents, coaches, kids, and we're looking at the competitive pathway overall holistically about how that impacts the regions, the mini tours, MJT and CJGA. It's really crucial that we get the next wave of players coming up properly through that system. Our work with the World Junior Girls, filling a void that wasn't there. It'll be the seventh year that we're hosting the World Junior Girls at Angus Glen Golf Club this year. And it's just been a phenomenal event that has really given us that platform and a vehicle to show how good these female players are and to drive back community engagement and grow the game on the female side as well. And international competitions, we were lucky to host the Astor Trophy, which is an event every 4 years between five countries, and we used it. We had it at Royal Colwood last year in BC, and they're subsequently going to host the 2023 Women's Am. So with that tournament, we really looked at female golf in Victoria and what we could do over the next 5 years as a lead up to these events. So to use these as a vehicle and grow the female side of the game is really important to us. A tool and resource you'll see coming out. I spoke quickly about the competitive pathway. It's going to be, we've had many conversations with the provincial associations about, you know, where do we tell people to go? If someone's asking the club, who do they call? Do they call Golf Canada? I've got tons of calls over my years. Do they call the province? Where do they go? So collectively, we've come up, we've looked at the pathway again and compared it to the long-term athlete development plan. So you can actually, it's an interactive visual on the site where you can see where each person should be, each player should be as they go through the stages, and then we'll have a full events listing that'll be comprehensive of every event in Canada. So hopefully that's a benefit and something new that the clubs will dig into. Rules of golf modernization, I will not give you a clinic. You probably don't want to know testing or anything like that, but the rules of golf was important because it was a chance for us to get to the clubs. We had over 700 seminars, club seminars across the country where all of our provincial staff and volunteers went in. There was over 7,000 people that attended these seminars to learn about the rules. So it was a good education piece. It wasn't just about the rules. We told them about everything that we're doing in golf, and we see the same opportunity with the World Handicap System. We're affiliated with the RNA, and they have over 140 countries affiliated with them. And through the promotion of the level one, just to educate our golfers about the changes in the rules, we had 35% of the world in terms of how many people went on this level one program. So hopefully, again, that benefited the clubs so that it improved pace of play. It was more welcoming for golfers. The rules were easier to understand. And I'm sure they probably played a few lateral penalty areas in between, even if you marked them or if you didn't mark them. So hopefully the rules sped up the game and made it more welcoming at your clubs. This is your quick quiz question. Flag stick, did everyone leave it in? Did you do this?
Oh my gosh.
Or that. Because you should have added two strokes if you did that. So you could leave it in, but after you hit it, don't do anything after that. The other initiative, the global initiative that's happening, there was an announcement in December just around amateur status. And essentially, amateur status is golfers that don't take compensation or don't get prize money or cash. It's for the enjoyment of the game. So there is that differentiation between amateur and professional. They are going to modernize these. There are a few nuances which make it a little bit challenging for the National Golf Federations. We're kind of stuck in the middle. We're the governing body and the authority, but we're also trying to grow the game and grow participation. That's our vision. That's what we're meant to do, to be a world leader. So the new one that I want to tell you for 2020, and we get a ton of questions through our rules and amateur status email, is around hole-in-one. So in 2012, the rules for hole-in-one changed that it's a lucky shot. You can accept anything. If you're playing a round of golf, you can accept anything for a hole-in-one. Some of you might not think it's a lucky shot, and I've heard some ridiculous numbers over the last couple of days of how many people have. But in terms of this, for a hole-in-one for 2020, now you can run hole-in-one contests outside of the golf course or outside of a golf game. So if it's on the driving range, if it's in a simulator, you can even do mini putt if you want. The only caveat is that it needs to be 50 yards or more. So we wanted to quickly show you Derek Ingram's recent hole-in-one at the
They're going to go Scottsdale. Nuts when he hits this thing.
I'm just trying to get the social team more followers. If you haven't seen it, you got to follow us. So, that was a quick overview. I will pass it up next on the tee, Sean Hall from Golf Canada as well, our senior director of handicap and course rating. Senior manager, sorry, Sean.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, first and foremost, for all being here with us today. I'm not going to take up a lot of your time this morning. I know handicapping isn't necessarily the top of everyone's mind, but it is mine. It's been close to my heart for a while now since I've started with Golf Canada, and very happy to be here and discuss it with you. You know, it's an important and exciting time for handicapping right now in Canada and in the world. With the advent and the release of the World Handicap System, there's a lot of great stuff coming, and it's a real good opportunity for us to communicate and to re-engage with it, with our clubs, with our provincial associations, and to really open up that line of communication, because, again, it's a very exciting time, and it's a busy time, yes, but like I said, a lot of great work has gone into it across the world and across Canada, and I do want to take this opportunity to thank the National Committee that has been so important and so helpful with the release of the World Handicap System. I know we have a number of them in the room today, so thank you to the committee for all your help and all your work throughout this last little bit. But as a quick overview of what the World Handicap System is, you know, it's been a work in progress. It's been going on for 7 years, the discussions on the international stage, in terms of getting this in place, you know, getting a unified system of handicapping in place where we didn't have one before. Working with 6 different handicap authorities was, of course, a bit of a process, and I wasn't there for all of it. Craig Lockery, who previously represented Golf Canada on the committee, he can tell you some stories, I'm sure, about some of the discussions that went into it early on. But it's definitely been a process, and we're happy to say now that it is released. The World Handicap System released January 8th in Canada this year, and pretty successfully. It's a bit of a soft launch, of course, because as you've seen outside, we don't have a lot of golf courses that are open. But looking forward to active season starting across the country very soon. Today I'm going to be talking a bit more on the handicapping side of it. One thing that is kind of interesting to mention is the World Handicap System includes both the rules of handicapping and the course rating system, all under that one umbrella. I think we kind of look at it as more the handicapping side of it, but it does look at both of them because they work so closely together. So I'll be talking a bit more about the rules of handicapping today, giving a bit of an update on what's happened so far and what's to expect. So having said that, we'll move into a bit of a nice video here. It's one that was recently released. I like it. It kind of touches a bit more to the emotional side of it. And there's some really good mention of making sure you're posting scores. So that's one thing that I'm a big fan of.
Do you remember the first time?
Do you remember the first time you played a round of golf and kept score?
Then the satisfaction of submitting your score.
And then doing it again and again.
Eventually turning in enough scores to get your handicap.
I remember those feelings.
And the excitement of seeing that number next to my name.
Wow, is that a great feeling.
Denise, what'd you get?
I had a par.
Nice.
Whether you play all the time.
Just a weekend golfer.
Or even someone new to the game.
Everyone who plays can establish a handicap.
And realize the same benefits.
Tracking their progress.
Sharing a fair game with family and friends.
And most of all, having fun.
At four net three.
And now we want to make all those things easier
and more accessible for everyone
with the World Handicap System.
The World Handicap System.
Golf has been evolving and modernizing.
And now the major handicap systems in the world
are coming together
into one unified system.
No matter your skill level
and wherever you play,
the system has been designed for all golfers
by providing a consistent measure of your ability
and to encourage everyone to get a handicap.
Regardless of ability,
age, gender,
or nationality.
We all have a part to play in making this a success.
So let's get ready for it.
By learning what the new system is all about.
Get out there, have some fun.
Play with the family,
your friends,
or anyone that wants to have a game.
And make sure when you finish playing,
submit your scores.
So there we have it, a nice little video. I think that it really starts to set the tone for how we can use the World Handicap System release to change the way we talk about it. You know, lots of mention of fun, playing with family, getting out there, having a good time. It's not about competition as much. It's providing equitable opportunities to play across any skill level. It's no longer a handicap is only used just for competitive purposes. So, you know, fun little video, and hope that everybody enjoyed it. So what are we really trying to do with the World Handicap System? You know, we look at it here, and the purpose of the World Handicap System, of course, is to enhance the enjoyment of the game of golf and give as many golfers as possible to, you know, have the opportunity to obtain and maintain a handicap index, use their handicap index on any golf course now around the world, and compete or play casual rounds with anyone else on a fair and equal basis. And the one thing I can really get you walking away from today, in terms of my time on stage here, is what we're doing here, the basic fundamentals of handicapping has not changed. We're still trying to achieve the same things, offering equitable opportunities to compete and have fun and get out there. So, you know, we talk a lot about the release and we talk about some of these changes, and there are some bigger ones and some smaller ones, but let's all remember that what we're trying to do here has not changed, but it's just evolving, and that's never a bad thing in this world. So when I'm talking today about the changes, I'm going to kind of break it down. We won't go into each of these in full depth today, but I'm going to look at it a bit from how does it impact the golfer, but also how is it impacting the clubs. A lot of great club representation in the room here today, and I think that it's important to know about how are some of these changes going to affect some of your operations or some of the decisions that are being made at the club level or even competitive levels. So what we're looking at here is it's a great little graphic that kind of shows some of the changes that we're looking at with the World Handicap System in relation to some of the key principles. So the key principles are those shown in the blue circles. And you know, we want to make sure that through the World Handicap System, we're being inclusive and accessible, we're being consistent and portable with the approach to it, and also modern and adaptable. So if we start on, I guess, your left, my right, if we're looking at the inclusive and accessible, there's those different aspects that really go towards this, and you might see as well that some of these aspects do kind of blur the lines between different principles, which even goes to further strengthen what we're trying to do here. So when we're looking at you know, the changes of the minimum number of scores, for example, allowing golfers or new golfers to membership to establish an index that much quicker, as well as the new maximum handicap index of 54.0, which is now regardless of gender. So maximum 54.0 for any golfer. What this is really doing is it's allowing us to get new golfers or new golfers to handicapping involved more quickly, but also making sure that our higher handicap golfers are getting the strokes that they need. We always knew that they existed out there. They were capped at a different number, but now they're getting out and they're getting the strokes they need, which is really going to allow us to provide better benefit for it, because now they're going to say, you know what, I'm actually able to go out and play against, you know, a friend of mine, and we'll play pretty evenly versus in the past being a bit more limited. Looking through the consistent and the portable side of it, you know, those are three aspects that that just allow us to provide that basic foundation for how it's being applied across the world, but across Canada. So, you know, we have the inclusion now of the abnormal course and weather conditions, so the playing conditions calculation. You know, having a bit more accuracy in terms of the handicap index calculations and the inclusion of the memory side of it through the low index, and just how we've made some changes to the playing handicap and the course handicap calculations. The one thing that I always do like to talk about in this is the modern and adaptable, because Canada's been a leader in this for a number of years already. You'll look at each of these 3 points here, and you know, it probably seems like old hat to a lot of us because we're so used to seeing it. But when you look on the international scale, and even if you look to, you know, our partners in the U.S., some of this hasn't really been in place before, and we've been that leader, and it's pretty exciting for us to be that. So, you know, one of the main ways that we can see that is through the daily revisions, of course. We in Canada are used to seeing live updates to your handicap factor at the time, index now. But in the past, there's been a lot of associations, national associations, that haven't been doing it. It's the revisions on the 1st and the 15th. And the last one there, it's really important to mention as well, you know, integration of nine-hole scores, of course, has always been something that we've been used to, but the accommodation of local cultures. And when you bring all these different countries together to find and build one unified system, it's very important to accommodate local cultures. So that's making sure that, you know, proper playing formats are being maintained and recognized and worked into the system. So a lot of great, exciting information right there. So we'll go through and we'll look at a bit more in depth. I do want to be mindful and respectful of everyone's time today. I know that I think this is the last session before the break, so I want to make sure everybody can get up and stretch their legs. So what we'll do is we'll start off and we'll look at what's changed. And these are a bit more of the overarching changes along with the World Handicap System. So ones that you might see affect the golfer a bit more, it's going to involve less inclusion of the clubs. So some of these factors, the club doesn't really have to get into it and take action. We'll look at those on the next slide a little bit. But some of the main changes that we're looking at with the World Handicap System is, of course, the change from the handicap factor to the handicap index. We've always been used to, well, we've been trying to be used to calling it the handicap factor previously, but we get all names for it. But now that it is one unified system, everyone's going to carry a handicap index. Everyone knows what it is. Everyone's going to be calling it and referring it to the same way. So it's really going to help that that communication and that dialogue around it. The handicap index calculation itself has changed slightly. We're moving to a bit more of an average-based system with some slight tweaks to the number of scores that are being included. So we're now looking at the low 8 of the most recent 20 scores, score differentials, versus previously it was the low 10. So a few little changes in there, but what we're really looking at is with this new index calculation is it's a system that reflects demonstrated playing ability. We used to always refer to it as potential playing ability, but now we're actually looking at it as being a more accurate reflection of what your demonstrated ability is, which I think is a great update to it. As we continue on, the low handicap index, it's a new term for us here in Canada. Basically what that does is it acts as a memory. So your low index is the lowest index that you've held over the previous 365 days. At my first meeting representing Canada on the world level, we had about an hour long discussion, of course, whether it should be 12 months or 365 days, because of course the first year of implementation is a leap year. So that was always a good introduction into it. But what it does, it just provides a bit of a framework, a bit of a reference point for your demonstrated ability over the previous year, and acts as a bit of a reference point for some of our safeguards that are now built into the system. Looking through the playing conditions calculation, it's a new process involved. It has been used across the world quite successfully in the past. The one thing that I will mention in this, it's under this section because there is no additional information that's needed to be entered by either the golfer or the clubs. We had some early questions, of course, saying, well, how am I going to enter the wind speed today and the amount of rain and how, you know, deep the rough was because we didn't get to cut. If I can put your minds at ease, there's no extra work involved in this. It's something that goes on behind the scenes. It's just a statistical analysis, basically, of the scores that are entered in comparison to the expected scoring patterns to determine if an adjustment needs to be made. So it's really going to help improve the accuracy of the handicap indexes. And then moving into the last one that I'll talk about on this slide is the exceptional scores. And what this does is it really recognizes when somebody plays exceptionally well and they've demonstrated that they can play well. So it's a potential adjustment. This is an opportunity, and coming out of some of our leadership meetings a little bit earlier this week, this is a great chance to actually talk about it, because we're not looking at exceptional scores as being a penalty. It's not a bad thing. It should be a cause for celebration that, you know what, you go out there and you play exceptionally well. Let's be proud of that. We all talk about wanting to track our game and wanting to improve, hopefully. So look at this more as this is a great opportunity. This is a badge of honor now that you've actually been able to go out and you played exceptionally well. So now if we go a bit more into how it impacts the golf club. So these are some of the ones that, you know, will have an impact. A lot of questions that we're getting from clubs are around these. Know that you're not alone, you know, between the Provincial Associations of Golf Canada. We're here to help guide you through this, and there's going to be a lot of great resources coming out and made available to the clubs to help with implementing this and educating and informing your golfers. One of the top ones that we're getting a lot of questions on is on par. Par is playing a lot more of an important role in the handicap system now, whereas in the past it wasn't so much. You know, if you look at it, as par is now involved in how we adjust our hole scores. It's involved in our course handicap calculations. It is more of an impact. And this was a choice that, you know, par resonates well with golfers, whereas course rating might not. Course rating and slope rating might not. So by now establishing par as our reference point, it allows us to better communicate and make sure that our golfers better understand what it is we're trying to do here. And of course, with the side of it, you know, there's flexibility involved in establishing par, a lot of great guidelines in terms of how do we know what's a par 4, a par 5, with some flexibility built into it to take into consideration the difficulty of the hole, and also how the hole was designed to be played. So, you know, it's great to see that. We're not mandating down saying it has to be this, it has to be this. It's a communication between the provincial associations and the clubs. When we're looking at adjusting hole scores, this is another one where we've seen a lot of questions. Everyone's probably heard of the net double bogey and maybe had some questions, some confusion around it potentially. It is a new way of looking at what a maximum hole score is for handicap purposes. And what it is, you know, it is a change, and yes, we definitely understand and recognize that it's a change, and it'll take some golfers some time to get used to it. But there's a lot of great tools available for that in terms of, you know, the Golf Canada mobile app with the course handicap calculator and posting hole by hole, having it automatically adjust hole scores. So it is a change. I look at it as an opportunity that anytime we get a question in, it's a touch point, an opportunity to talk to those golfers or talk to those clubs. And I encourage each of the clubs in the room to do the same. We have had some changes in the number of scores required to obtain a handicap index. So that's a little bit lower now. Now you need a minimum of 54 holes, and that can be any combination of 18 or 9 hole scores. And kind of the cool thing with this is that, you know, over my time in the industry, I've gotten a lot of questions saying, you know, we have a member guest starting on Saturday, and I want to get this person in, and they require a handicap, but they can't play 5 rounds in enough time. And it's kind of good because we're making it that much easier, we're making it that much more accessible to establish a handicap index to those that are new to the game or new to handicapping. Course handicap, of course, has been changing. We've updated a little bit of the formula for it to include now course rating and par values in the calculation of your course handicap. You will see more of a variation now between tees, maybe at your own course, maybe from the forwards to the backs. But what it's doing is it's just, again, it's putting it to a different reference point of par. So people see that what they're used to as their course handicap from the middle tees may have changed, but when you actually look at it, it's changing pretty consistently for everybody. So we're looking at still maintaining that relative equity, and also remembering that we're using par as our benchmark now and not the course rating. That was always a difficulty that golfers had a tough time of understanding how course rating factored into it, especially with target score, but now bringing par back into it as a term that resonates really helps clear that up. And then the playing handicap, that is something that the clubs need to be aware of, because if you do have any types of terms of the competition, any handicap allowances being applied, playing handicap actually means that now, that if you're applying any of those, that's where you're going to be going out and you're playing in the competition with. Last of which, the stroke index allocation. There are changes to the recommendations for how we determine the stroke index allocations, so your stroke holes. So it's now actually going to be a feature of the course rating data. So we have a number of trained, awesome volunteers out there, our core training volunteers, and they're looking at the exact information that we've always tried to kind of achieve through the chokehold allocations. So it's now going to be a feature of that. It's available through your provincial associations as a resource if you are looking at reviewing that at the course. But what I will say with a lot of this kind of thing, especially with PAR and with the stroke index allocation, we're not asking you to go tomorrow and reprint your scorecards. We've got a lot of questions on that, and we're not saying that now with a stroke index allocation procedure changing, we're not saying you have to, but it's a rule. Sorry, it's a resource and a tool there for the next time that you're ready to review that. We understand it's a process, and we look at WHS overall, and just because it's launched doesn't mean we're done communicating, doesn't mean we're done with this. It's going to be ongoing. We're going to be having a lot of discussions, a lot of work ahead of us. But like I said, look at it as an opportunity to speak with your golfers and speak with your clubs to really benefit from it. So like I said, don't expect to have to go out there and burn your 10,000 scorecards you still have left and buy new ones. But look at it for the next time you're looking at reprinting. So we've talked a little bit about what's happened so far, the changes. So basically, what can we expect next? The one that I keep going back to, of course, is communication, because it's very important in handicapping. It's very important in the golf. And like I said, the release of the World Handicap System, I really truly believe that it's a catalyst. It's an opportunity for discussion and to re-engage with our golfers. We've had a lot of great interest and feedback coming in through the Golf Canada offices. People asking questions, people wanting to know more, asking where to find more information. So let's take advantage of that and let's really use this as an opportunity to get people aware of it and to bring new golfers into it. There's going to be a lot of communications coming out from Golf Canada and provincial associations, providing guidance, additional information, and a number of really helpful resources to help you better communicate with your golfers. So we have a resource page available right now to the provinces to help share out a lot of this information so that we have consistent messaging being applied. And that's only going to increase. We're going to continue to add more resources and share that out. One of the other things that we're kind of excited about is the releasing of a handicap newsletter to be able to speak with those that are involved in the handicap side of it, the handicap committees, the handicap chairs. And really creating that ongoing communication so that we're not looking at after the active season starts where we're done until next year, but we want to maintain and engage with our golfers consistently across the season and across the year. The one ask that I will say for this in terms of the newsletter is let's just make sure that we have the right contact information so we know who we need to talk to. Certification and licensing, of course, is part of this. There are going to be a lot of educational opportunities put on primarily by the provinces to offer certification opportunities for your clubs, for your handicap committees, because we want to make sure that everyone is well aware of the new system, what changes are made, and how to answer those questions first and foremost. So a lot of great resources for that. Please see your local provincial association for schedules, and then there will, of course, be an online version of that available shortly. Licensing, we just recently shared the information out. There will be new handicap license agreements. It's just been updated to reflect some of the changes on the world handicap side of it. It's nothing too scary, nothing too crazy, but it is important to remember that we do need to outline what responsibilities are on both sides of the coin with the implementation and the administration of the handicapping system. And the last point here that I'll really look at is questions from golfers, and I've said it a few times. We're going to get a lot. We've had a lot of questions, but let's look at that as a positive thing. I know it's tough when it's an email or phone call coming in just before you're hitting your tee time, but it's a positive thing. Questions are a really good thing, and we want to encourage those. And we might have a couple minutes to take some questions from the group afterwards, but when we're talking about our golfers, let's encourage those questions, and let's offer them the opportunity to learn more. And of course, I'm always here to help if any guidance is needed or if there's any support needed. And I know I'll speak for the rest of the provinces as well as the national committee that we're all on the same page and excited to be helping and answering those questions. So having said that, that's kind of the end of my little section. So not sure what time, but I'm gonna invite Adam up real quick. If we have a couple of quick questions, please feel free. And so it's either for Adam or myself. I don't know if we're going to do mics or not, but we have one in the back corner here.
George,
So you're talking scores, you're talking like a full round, correct? Yeah, so you know, this is where we start to get into my handicapping hat, and of course we want everybody, and you know, based on the rules of handicapping, you should be posting all acceptable scores. It's like anything in life, there are goals that that individual clubs may be able to set in terms of, okay, let's focus this year on making sure people know what are acceptable scores. And you know, talking about the fun side of it, once we start getting people engaging with it a bit more, and you know, there's a great number of golfers out there that are engaged with the handicap system and see the values of it, but it's those ones that might be maybe posting one score a year, but they're playing 20. Once we get them involved in it, and once we communicate with them, they see, oh geez, this is the benefit of it. By actually having a handicap index that's reflective of my ability, I can go out and play and have fun because it is accurate. It is actually specific to me now, versus if they're not posting scores, of course they're not going to see the value as much because, you know, they might not be getting the strokes they're entitled to, or maybe they're getting more than they're entitled to, and you're the three playing partners are going to let you hear about it, right? So it's definitely a full team effort for it. You know, sharing the benefits and the purpose behind it and what you can do with a handicap. And that's definitely something that the clubs can do is, you know, if you are hosting events, if they are, you know, a net event, or if it is handicap as a terms of the competition for entry, make sure that we use it. Make sure we're using the official ones, and, you know, the committee can definitely take that time to say, you know what, I saw Adam, you're playing in the event, and you've only posted 8 scores last year, and we know that's a low year for you. What's going on? You know, just start having those conversations, and it will be a process that, you know, as of January 8th, it's not like everybody's minds are going to change immediately, and that's where the communication side comes into it for sure.
We'll take one or two more, just in the interest of time, to make sure we don't get that much more beyond our time. But we do have the marketplace as well at the break and at lunch. But yeah, we'll take one or two questions from the floor.
Sorry, I think we're over here. Oh, sorry. Oh, my apologies. So that's my confusion. So when we're talking about hole-by-hole score posting, it's, you know, a lot easier to do. It takes some of the extra work out of the hands of the golfer, especially with net double bogey and some concerns that the golfers think that it's difficult to apply. Yes, there are ways that we can go through. Clubs have the opportunity to set default score posting methods, so you can say, okay, we as a club are asking our golfers to post hole by hole, and we're defaulting our system to do that. So that's the first option that they come into. So you're now eliminating that one or two clicks to say, okay, to find hole by hole, I have to go here, and putting it right in front of them. And yes, there's definitely going to be communications and help coming out to help identify that. We've made changes to the mobile app, which makes it a little bit easier to post hole by hole, as well as identifying stroke index allocations and where you receive those strokes. So there definitely are tools, and there's communications that will continue to come out, pushing towards hole-by-hole score posting. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So that would be coordinated through us. So based on the provider, the software kind of thing, there needs to be more control now on the calculation side of it, especially if we look at PCC, the analysis that happens behind the scenes on that one. So all calculations will be run centrally through a central source, but that doesn't mean that we don't welcome opportunities for pushing scores and pulling information. So it's a process of working with our vendor and with GolfNet, who kind of services the score center, to build that out. We're looking at providing a bit more structure for that process to make sure that everything, again, is being applied consistently. I'd say let's take that offline a little bit. Once we start crossing some international borders, then we just have to kind of dive a bit deeper into the conversation, but it's a conversation that's welcome.
Yeah.
No, so if you're posting the same, so if you're posting a hole-by-hole score, let's say the situation is where there's no adjustments made for, you know, net double bogey or anything like that. A score posted as a hole-by-hole versus a gross score still have the same impact. It's just with the hole-by-hole score posting, it helps us with the adjustment for net double bogeys and such. And I see that I have a shadow beside me here, so I think it's time to get the hook and pull me out. But again, thank you everybody for listening. If there's any other questions, please let us know.
I try not to do the hover, just the casual hover. Thank you, Sean and Adam. And once again, all of our panelists will be available for additional questions so you can pick their brains. It is now time for a brief break. We're going to return at 11:15, so you have a chance to stretch your legs. And again, we'll return back here for 11:15. Thank you.